Hello, this is Heilung, and we are answering 10 questions for metal injection. Well, what a lot of bands usually do behind the curtain, we do in front of the curtain, right? So, like, there's all these things bands used to do, holding hands, having a shot tequila together, and like whatever kind of creepy or funny stuff. But when you see us appearing on stage and we do the smudging and like circling up, that is our ritual that we do before the ritual, right?
Yeah, but it's also we have of course also things that we do privately when we are in the studio. For instance, if we're going to work with a particular piece that requires some special attention, for instance, we worked with some plague bones from a mass grave in Germany, and there it felt natural to do a ritual saying thanks to these people who lived and died and now are part of a musical project. And so it's according to the surroundings that we are in, we are mindful to our surroundings.
I always thought when you had that bow with the human hair on the Ravanhata, I thought that was very strange.
Yeah, that's actually a good one, because the instrument builder, he cut little locks of hair from his daughters to make bows that you, like a harp, violin bow, right? So this Indian instrument was played on with human hair. That's pretty strange, but yeah, we must have something even stranger.
Well, so in the song Kriskelde, I can reveal that we recorded this mostly outside, actually, in the garden outside the previous studio we had, and what appears as sword sounds and weaponry and all that is basically just garden tools. I mean, but it sounds so basic. I mean, but you know, that's the thing, right? Like when you create music like this, you know, you just grab what you have around you, right, and you use it as instruments, right?
And if it sounds good,
I mean, like they had probably garden tools too back in the day, and they would probably play on them. I mean, you know, who am I to say that they didn't?
I wouldn't say it is in response to the pandemic. I think that would be too far, because like when it comes to when it comes to the deepest root of it all, where it all comes from, that is like a little archive I keep, and it just flows out there naturally, more or less, right? So like, and generally I think we don't do music that is like, you know, from today. We don't even do music that is from like yesterday. We do music that is like 1,000 years old and more, right? So, no, I would say it's a safe answer, right?
Well, we always felt that there should be children's voices in the beginning of Tenet. Yeah, it's the two daughters of my best friends from Norway. So yeah, one was 6 and the other one was 8 when we did the recordings.
Yeah, I mean, we deal with a lot of, you know, archaic themes particularly this song. But one thing I personally was very inspired of is there's this children's game where they draw in on the street, and they can you know, what is that called in English, even
charcoal, and then you jump 1, 2, 3, I don't know the English.
Hopscotch. Okay. And you know, I think that is a thing children probably must have done for thousands of years, right? And that energy to it, and also like the energy of having children learning this amazing Satsu Square, also that kind of feeling is what I wanted to hear in the beginning. And these kids are just amazing, and we had them with us for the first listening session, and see their eyes, you know, glow up, and how proud they were to be part of this. You know, it was the right energy for that song, I think.
I always say the same. Marduk is my favorite. That was from the beginning. When it started coming out of the speakers, I loved it, and it brought me to tears several times during the production. And still, like today, it still touches me every time.
Yeah, well, as you say, they're all our babies, but Anuana is very special to me. I think also because when Kai presented the lyrics, I just sang it directly from the sheets without thinking. The melody was just there. It just spoke to me very clearly. And I think the video turned out being very also, caught the spirit of the song and made it even closer to my heart. So, yeah, gotta say that one.
Yeah, so... and I've also answered this question before, but for me, my favorite song is Drift. And to explain that is because in my shoes as producing the album, I produce albums as one piece, right? You wouldn't watch a movie and just take like a segment out and say, what's your favorite segment of that movie, right? And I feel very much like that Drift is as you say also, and it is a collection and a kaleidoscope of songs that wanted to be together, so to say. It was never planned exactly for those songs to become together, but they just were drawn to each other. And that is a part where an album can achieve its own consciousness, in my view, when the art dictates how it wants to be, no matter how much you try to steer the boat as the caretaker and as we as composers, you know, it wanted to be like this. And for that reason, you know, even though we have, and I personally have hundreds of albums behind me by now, it's just to still be in a position where you are not fully in control of the art that you're creating makes it that much more beautiful to me. And that's why my favorite song is Drift.
Yeah, I would like to answer for my sake that the Nesso touched me personally, because the ancient story, or in this spell, there's a story about an animal being hurt, and the illness being depicted as worms, and the spell goes out on drawing the worms out and drawing the worms into an arrowhead. At least that's one of the interpretations, and then you would shoot the arrow into the far woods to get rid of the disease. And I just think that picture is so beautiful, that you draw something out into something else and you shoot it away. I think that's a beautiful spell.
I mean, there's so many. I mean, but yeah, I was also personally very touched by Nesso.
Yeah,
for sure. Mm-hmm. That is the first thing that stands in mind, I would say. Like we were all, I think we can maybe all agree on that. Even, you know, we were all sitting in the studio and really feeling this moment together, I think, and is one of the absolute highlights.
I hope there's a lot of misunderstood things, because I mean, like, we're consciously keeping a lot of things secret, or like, you know, very low profile, right? In order to inspire people to think, inspire them to dig deeper, you know, inspire them to get a different perspective on something, right? And that all usually can start with like, was that really what they were thinking? Or was that really what they were meaning? I remember when we were still in charge of, like when we three were still taking care for the social media, we had this like short, very weird messages, and we were like, you know, waiting for the comments, like, you know.
that's always funny, but misunderstanding is always a question of perspective, right? So I think there's a lot of people out there who have, like, for example, a Christian background, you know, who just see us for a second and then get like this Satan impulse, and then they're done with it, right? So
yeah, actually, I read a comment on our social media the other day, and there's this woman writing that this looks evil, and it's a picture of Maria standing in her beautiful white dress on stage with a tree behind her, yeah. And she thinks that looks evil. So I wrote back, which I never do, but I really felt compelled. So I said, if she dared to join our ritual, we will plant one tree for her too.
Remember that we all are brothers, all people, and beasts, and trees,
and stone, and winds. We all descend from the one great being that was always there before people lived and named it, before the first seed sprouted.
I like the explanation of that metal comes from the deep, dark grounds, but around it is the earth, which is even blacker, right? And that's where Heilung comes from. Anything else?
Well, it also helps that the label we are on is distributing a lot of metal music, I guess. I think we can safely say that we have all kinds of people, attending our rituals, and it gets more and more colored, which I really love. But I guess that within this particular field and this genre, there is an interest in exploring music that is not the norm, and that is not the normal thing that is coming out of your speaker in your car or whatever, right? And Heilung is definitely not that, right? It speaks to something primal and something that, we don't have the necessary 2.5 minute long song that goes into one ear and out of the other. You actually demand the listener to sit down and reflect over what they're listening to. And I think like these type of intricate arrangements you find very often also in metal, I think. And it's clever music, at least metal. I don't want to touch on whether we are clever in anything we do, but I dare to think that we are maybe speaking to something primal in you, and it's lovely to see that reaction from that audience. Yes.
New is the new findings, because there's a lot of stuff in the ground still, but sometimes it just comes up. And like, for example, there's, when you go to our merchandise, there's one hoodie that has like this stylized horses on the sides. And one day we're sitting in the studio, that was for the last album, for Futha, and suddenly Maria like gets, I think it was you got the message from your archaeologist friend who like literally has like, you know, two coins in his hand or her hand, and just took a photo and says, hey, we just dig that out. And that photo ended up on my desk, and I made the drawings, and that went straight into the album production, right? So these coins are around 1,200 years old, but they're also brand new, right?
Thank you so much for watching, and thank you for asking us nice questions. Mm-hmm.